Good morning, sir. Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Can we proceed?
Yes, sir. So let us start the meeting by prayer song. Prayer song, welcome, sir.
Can you start now?
Sir, after prayer song, welcome, then you start, sir.
When I am down and oh my soul so weary, when troubles come and my heart burdened be, then I am still and waiting in silence until you come and see.
Okay, sir. So, a very good morning to everyone. Before welcoming everyone, I would like to tell briefly about Sister Rosamma's endowment lecture. Sister Rosamma is the former HOD of Department of Physics, Holy Cross College, Nagarkoil. She offered her 27 years of service as a head of the department. She was working day and night for the development of our department. She was kind enough in shaping and molding the students both academically and spiritually. When she got retirement in May 2007, she deposited ₹25,000 in bank. Every year we are getting interest for the amount which is spent beneficially for the welfare for students as an endowment lecture. Today, this endowment lecture is to be conducted for the memory of Sister Rosamma. On behalf of our department, our hearty gratitude to you, dear sister. May God's abundant blessings and good health be upon you, dear sister. Now I would like to welcome our resource person, Professor Dr. K. Navaneetha Krishnan, former head and coordinator, School of Physics, Madurai Kamaraj University, Madurai. He has abundant knowledge in quantum mechanics, solid state physics, and theoretical computations. He has more than 45 years of service in teaching and research in Madurai Kamaraj University. 8 scholars were awarded PhD degree under his able guidance. One among the scholars is our beloved sister, Dr. Geraldine Jayam. Now he is with us to deliver the endowment lecture on the topic Career in Physics. On behalf of everyone present here, a warm welcome to you, sir. Welcome.
Okay.
Next, I extend my sincere welcome to our ever-loving sister, Dr. Geraldine Jayam, Secretary and Professor of Physics, who is always taking care of the department to succeed in many fields. She has authored many books related to our curriculum. She has more than 40 years of service in teaching and research. Dear sister, on behalf of everyone present here, I extend you a warm welcome.
Thank you, Nirmala.
Next, I would like to welcome all my colleagues who worked hard for arranging this endowment lecture successfully. Welcome, dears. Last but not the least, I would like to welcome our UG, PG, MPhil and research scholars. Welcome, dear students. Once again, I welcome you all. Thank you. Okay, sir, now you can start the...
Okay. My dear students and faculty, good morning to you all. I am Dr. Navanitha Krishnan, former professor in physics, Madurai Kamaraj University, delivering this lecture. I am happy to deliver this lecture under Dr. Sister Rosamma. I know her as I have come across several times to your college, and I found her as a good teacher. Also, she underwent an MPhil program in our School of Physics, so that I found that she was an excellent teacher, might have been an excellent teacher. And as your HOD pointed out, she has spent several years of selfless service for the society of the students, for welfare of the students, and she has shaped young minds for better goals. So I join you in admiring her services, and I wish her all the best. Now, I must first tell you about the facilities available for physics students in different walks of life. So you should really be happy for choosing physics as your subject. The reasons are the following. Number one, physics, which was called natural philosophy during the period of Newton, is the mother of all sciences. Quantitatively, we understand the nature as it exhibits several phenomena, be it astronomy, nuclear physics, or particle physics, whatever it is. Mathematics is, of course, the backbone of physics. So without mathematics, physics cannot survive, because being a quantitative subject, and you should somehow develop an interest in mathematics as well. Technology, or as we call it as applied physics, is a way of physics by which it reaches the common man. The principles of physics are employed in engineering and medical instruments. Many of the medical instruments, or almost all instruments that we see in engineering, in our day-to-day applications, are all based on physics principles. So if either the fabrication of these instruments or servicing require skilled personnel, maybe engineers or physicists. Job opportunities, therefore, are better for physics students. Your training in physics helps the mind to adapt to any profession and bring about innovations or improvements. Physics is like an incomplete building. So it cannot be compared with subjects in arts like Shakespeare's work, or Milton's work, or Shelley's work, or Keats' work, or Rabindranath's work. They are all complete by themselves, and you and I cannot do anything more on that except reading and enjoying. But physics is not like that. So it is like an incomplete building, and our knowledge in many areas are still limited. So you will understand more as I proceed further. So therefore, every achievement is to add a small piece of this in this incomplete building. The foundations are laid very strong because they are based on experimental results. Rarely we come across earth-shaking discoveries. Some examples are quantum theory and relativity. Both require new theories to go beyond the Newtonian mechanics. A third example is the observation of five-fold rotational symmetry in crystallography. Only 1, 2, 3, 4, and 6-fold rotations are consistent with the translational symmetry in crystallography. Later, it was shown that there was no violation of Bravais lattices, as was shown by Roger Penrose, the so-called Penrose tiling, where with the two different types of rhombus, one can fill the space also, which will exhibit long-range ordering. And incidentally, this Dr. Roger Penrose got the Nobel Prize last year. And such crystals are called quasi-crystals. Since science, in particular physics, is like an incomplete building, there is scope for everyone to contribute. So you can also contribute, both even as a student. We shall see how we can contribute. Also, since our knowledge is limited, we have For example, a wave particle dualism at the microscopic level. Microscopic particles in motion exhibit wave nature. That is what is called, what we call as quantum mechanics. And the same particles, when involved in collision, as in, for example, photoelectric effects or Compton effect or Raman effect, exhibit particle nature. So particles, for example, an electron, you may call it as a particle when it is involved in collision processes, or you may call it as a wave when it is in motion. Of course, relativity says that even when the particles at rest, there is an energy associated with that. But the wavelength we don't talk about when it is at rest. Also, since our knowledge is limited, as I said, we have, you know, an example, wave particle dualism. So when the particle just moves, so there is an associated wave with that particle, and there are ways to measure the wavelength of the particle, as suggested by de Broglie, for example. And then what is the form of the wave that is exhibited by the particle, whether it is exactly similar to that of an electromagnetic wave propagation or a sound wave propagation, or it is something different, that we shall see. Okay, or we require, therefore, some special knowledge to understand all these phenomena. We also require higher dimensions, for example, 4 in special relativity and more in general theory, which will puzzle us and bring about several interesting results, such as increase of mass with velocity, mass-energy relation, which leads to the invention of atom bombs and so on, length contraction, time dilation, etc. With the all these are my important applications. Curious ideas in quantum theory, such as the probability concept, even for a single particle, comma, non-commuting operators, spin, such as Fermi-Dirac, Bose-Einstein, in contrast to Maxwell-Boltzmann statistics, antiparticles, fusion, fission, dark matter, are all interesting and require our participation, because all this require more knowledge, and we may have to work hard to enlarge our vision and bring about some applications of all. Understanding is of course important, but more than that, application is more, much more important. In a solid, there are 10 to the power 28 atoms per meter cube, making exact theories non-existent, and approximate theories such as artifact or density functional theories or powerful numerical techniques are used. You are welcome to contribute not only in the above areas, but in every branch of physics. Finally, teaching and research positions are available to you. Getting through the NET examination or SET examination will make your entry into PhD or teaching in a college or university easier. But you have to work hard to get through that examination. It's not very difficult, and it's easy to get through as soon as you complete your MSc, because if you postpone that, as you go for higher education, your knowledge becomes limited in a particular area and you seem to forget the other areas. Therefore, as soon as you complete your MSc, you have to get through these exams. I am sure your college is offering you better training, and you should make use of all of them. Now, to shine as a good physicist, you require confidence and concentration. Without confidence, concentration is not possible. If somebody is able to achieve something, maybe an experiment or through theory, why not you can do it? In the same way, by going through the same procedure or by a different procedure. This is what is meant by confidence in you. For this, a good understanding of the subject is essential. Concentration, which is unwavering mind on your topic for hours together, if necessary, will definitely take you to greater heights. To achieve this, you require practice. Good health, naturally balanced food, yoga, meditation, or sports activity, all these will help you. Wealth is important in life. To achieve this, education and sports are the two methods. Both require hard work, former mental and the later physical. Think of Sachin Tendulkar, Vishwanathan Anand or Sidhu. They are millionaires through sports. But to safeguard the wealth, to spend it usefully, you require education. So education is a must. If you become a teacher, keep the following things in mind. Don't ever go to the class without preparation. You may become a teacher after getting a B.Ed. And you may end up in a high school or in a higher secondary school. Or you may go for higher education, M.Phil or Ph.D. Enter as a teacher, a professor in a college or university. But whatever it is, wherever you go, some ideas which I'm going to give you now are important. Please keep them in mind. Of course, there are other opportunities available to you, government jobs, bank jobs, and so on. In those jobs also, you can use your knowledge and you can try to improve yourself, improve the methodology that is followed in different steps. But I'm just talking about the teaching profession at present. Don't ever go to the class without preparation. The time available to you is just 45 minutes to 1 hour in the classroom. The presentation should be clear, continuous, and should motivate the student. Listen to the doubts raised by the students. You may answer immediately or in the subsequent classes after preparation. Our education system requires modification. For example, those people who get a doctorate degree, if there are 100 people, nearly 85 to 90% they become popular in Western countries like USA. But think of our situation here. Hardly we find 5% or 10%. And this is the same in other education systems also, in other lower levels also. So the system requires, maybe there is something wrong in our curricula, which require enormous modifications, and we have to think about how we can improve. Our exams should not only test the memory power, but also understanding of the candidate. And this is the one that is very important when you face entrance examinations like NET examinations or bank examinations or whatever it is. Your lecture should be for the average student, because the brilliant student somehow will be able to manage. And the poor student requires special attention, which he can do later. Encourage them to ask you questions. So only by questioning, it's a feedback to you. So you feel happy, the teacher feels happy that the student has understood at least a part of your lecture. Always remember that there is an expert sitting in the class evaluating you. This will sharpen your approach to teaching. After delivering the lecture, when you are free, recollect what you have taught. Can you modify the approach? If so, try next time. See how it is received. Then and there, compare yourself, I mean your achievements, with a similar person occupying a similar position in a better institution, maybe in an advanced country such as USA, UK, Germany, and so on. So this is for self-improvement. Use the blackboard and chalk piece in the classroom. This is my personal view. OHP or PowerPoint projection, these are useful only in seminars or in conferences where the majority of the audience are knowledgeable. For a classroom where most of the students are learning, blackboard and chalk piece is the best way of teaching, because as you proceed, the student can also follow you. And only for projecting three-dimensional pictures or complicated diagrams or very complicated expressions, lengthy expressions, which either may not be directly useful for your present lecture, or maybe just show them for some other purpose. And for these reasons alone, purposes alone, you should use the OHP or the PowerPoint projection. Otherwise, for classroom, the best way of teaching, in my opinion, is the chalk piece and the blackboard. There are ways to evaluate a scientist in a national laboratory, such as DRDO, BARC, Central Electrochemical Research Institute, Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, and so on. But it is difficult to evaluate a teacher. One may say, get feedback from the students. That is called a student evaluation of the teacher. So in my opinion, this is only partly correct. Because of personal feelings, personal opinions, the teacher may get a poor ranking. But anyway, it is a way. It is one of the ways of evaluating a teacher. The best way to judge the ability of your teacher is to see how the teacher has contributed to physics education. That means not only training the students and giving effective lectures, best lectures, but also try to find out some approximations involved in a derivation, for example. And the teacher can see whether the approximation can be relaxed and what is new coming out and so on. Or it may be a laboratory work, an experiment which is already designed and the students are going through the experiment. And can you modify it slightly so that it gives you some new ideas and so on and so forth. Now all this can be published, and this is called in journals like Physics Education or American Journal of Physics or American Physics Teacher and so on and so forth. And this is the one which will really help you, help the teacher to prove that she is the, or she or he is the best teacher. And of course, for scientists, front-ranking journals, international journals are available through which one can publish and become popular. And it may, who knows, one day it may even end up in a Nobel Prize. The pedagogical teaching is also very important, and the students can also contribute to this, because as they read, they can question why this approximation is made, why this concept is used. Well, can we think of some other concept involved, or can I think of some other way of approaching this problem? And all this one day will end up with some good results which may be published. Keep in mind that most of the important discoveries were made accidentally. X-rays, radioactivity, quantum Hall effect, high temperature superconductivity, to name a few. And research and teaching should give you mental satisfaction. It is true that you may not be rewarded immediately. It requires time for other scientists to appreciate your work. Einstein was denied a research position and an associate professor position at the University of Bern, even after publishing 4 papers in a year, each one becoming a subject by itself: photoelectric effect, relativity, Brownian motion, and specific heat of solids. All these 4 were contributed in the same year in a German journal called Endowment of Physics. In German, of course, he published it in German, and he was working as a patent in a patent office in Switzerland because he had a poor school education. But it's really surprising how he got all these ideas, even working as in an office. The dean of the science in that university called them as autistic. And there is no physics. So Einstein was not popular at that time, and his works were also not very popular. And later, of course, we all know that he is probably the best theoretical physicist of all times. A colleague of mine at MKU, Madurai Kamaraj University, applied for a job nearly 200 times, some of them even after PhD, and he could not get a job. Finally, he was absorbed in our own department. So don't lose heart if immediate success does not come. Some reasons are favoritism and corruption in our system, which are the main culprits, which have to be somehow eliminated. Now, another way to shine in physics or in science in general is to have a better role model. You may take some physicists as your role model, maybe because his or her experiment or theory you enjoyed so much, or with the simple physical concepts, Nobel Prize winning works were delivered. Two of the experiments which come to my mind immediately, one is the Stone Gerla experiment to prove that electron has a spin off. The experiment was extremely simple. The theory is also extremely simple. The energy involved when a magnetic moment is kept in a magnetic field is minus mu dot B, where B is the magnetic field and mu is the magnetic moment. So E is the energy. E is equal to minus mu dot B. And the force is the negative derivative of the energy, so which becomes let us say that in one dimension, let us take the variation is along the z direction, and therefore the force is equal to mu into dB by dz. Magnetic moment is a constant, so there is no derivative involved in that. So if you therefore change the magnetic field along the z direction somehow and allow the electrons to pass through, then depending upon the magnetic moment, you will have two different forces acting, one positive, another negative, and therefore you will get two patterns, one for the positive moment, another for the negative moment. This is a simple idea, not no big mathematics involved. But the fabrication of the magnet is important. And the Stone Gerla demonstrated that electron has a spin-off because it has two orientations. And later, of course, the same experiment was performed by other particles with the higher spin. So this experiment convincingly proved that spin exists and two times with the higher spin. So this experiment convincingly proved that spin exists and for the first time. Another experiment is that of the invention of cyclotron by Lorentz. And here also the physics involved is extremely simple. Now you have a simple pendulum oscillating harmonically, and every time when it reaches the maximum position, that's the maximum potential energy position, you just give a push and the amplitude slightly increases. Then go on doing it every time. Then you'll see the amplitude will go on increasing and the pendulum may even become anharmonic. And this is the simple idea that was used by Lorentz. And many of the students know how it was done by having a metallic disk separated into two parts, and a particle was put on one side, an electric field is applied, a charged particle was put on one side, electric field is applied, so the charge moves, and there is a perpendicular magnetic field, and there is an oscillating field also. So you adjust the field so that the frequencies match every time when the particle tries to come to a particular at the gap of the disk. Then it will go on increasing every time. And by this simple method, he was able to get velocities of particles, charged particles, comparable to the velocity of light. And for all that, the instrument was so simple that a cyclotron can be put inside your pocket. And of course, later, this idea was used to get much better instruments like the Davitron and so on and so forth. And there are many, many other experiments which you may think of. These are the two which come to my mind immediately. As a student, I had the following role models. At the BSc level, Newton, for all his discoveries in mechanics, equations of motion, or gravity, or attraction between planets or stars, the existence of the universe, or his achievements in optics, or his great achievements in mathematics. He discovered the calculus. He invented several numerical methods. So all this, and make Newton a giant in physics, a theoretical physics. Of course, he did some experiments as well. And the most important thing about Newton is that he somehow got the idea of corpuscular nature of light. We do not know how he got that idea, but using the corpuscular nature, he was able to explain reflection, refraction, and so on. And these details you don't find in recent textbooks. Some old textbooks in physics or in optics have this information at the elementary level. And this is the corpuscular nature of light, which is now what we call as quantum theory. Okay, and so Einstein is really Newton is really a very great personality. And next comes Einstein as quantum theory. Okay. And so Einstein is really, Newton is really a very great personality. And next comes Einstein. His achievements all of us know very well. And then Einstein, he has to be along maturity experiments and demonstrated that no such thing called the ether exists. And that gave a death blow to Maxwell's idea. And at the same time, it supported Einstein's theory of relativity. Light does not, a problem, light velocity doesn't depend upon the direction of propagation. So, and of course, I also had Niels Bohr as my favorite. Because along with Einstein, he also used a very novel idea that not only energy is quantized, but also angular momentum. So if you quantize angular momentum, then you are, when with some simple physical ideas, you are able to get the structure of hydrogen atom. He was able to explain all transitions, Balmer series, and so on, so forth. So therefore, he got the Nobel Prize, of course. And not only that, later, whenever Einstein questioned quantum mechanics, he was not happy with the development of quantum mechanics. So he called it as the black magic. He also went to the extent of saying that God does not play a game of dice, apparently referring to wave-particle dualism or probability theory, okay, concept, probability idea of a wave function in quantum mechanics. Einstein was not at all happy. But at every time, whenever he questioned this, it was Niels Bohr who came to the rescue of quantum mechanics. So Niels Bohr may be considered as the father of the modern quantum mechanics. Later, when I went to MSc or higher courses, the list included many more people. Enrico Fermi, an Italian physicist who first explained the puzzles in beta decay. The beta decay, as all of you know, is a part of radioactivity wherein electrons seem to come out. But the Rutherford atom model says that electrons cannot be there inside the nucleus. And so that's what was a puzzle. Why, how electrons come out in beta decay from the nucleus? And Enrico Fermi explained with his theory that it is a proton to neutron or neutron to proton conversion is responsible for this. So not only electrons come out, but also another particle called a neutrino, which has no mass, very negligible mass and no charge. And of course, it was postulated a little earlier by Wolfgang Pauli. Pauli also suggested, another great theoretical physicist, suggested that neutrino must be there, the particle must be there. And a little later after this, Fermi's theory, neutrino was discovered by Kovan and others. And they got Nobel Prize for that. And not only in theory, but in experiment also, Fermi excelled. For example, he was the person who first produced the atom bomb during the Second World War. The American government gave the responsibility and also made Oppenheimer, another physicist, as the director of that institute, of that project. So Enrico Fermi excelled both in theory and experiment. Then Wolfgang Pauli, Pauli's achievements spread over almost all areas of modern physics and in solid state physics. So, for example, when people were puzzled, why should there be two different electrons in the first orbit of the hydrogen atom with the different spins? Why not more and so on? It was Pauli who gave the exclusion principle. So you can accommodate only two electrons, one which spin up and another spin down. And later he gave the spin statistics theory using the field theoretic ideas, where he proved theoretically that particles with the spin off or off odd integer spins must obey Fermi-Dirac statistics. And the particles with integer spin, like photon or phonon and so on, they should obey Bose-Einstein statistics. And this is a great achievement by Wolfgang Pauli. And of course, he had many other achievements, like explaining why the Pauli paramagnetism, why it's temperature independent and so on in solids. Then comes the great Landau, the Russian theoretical physicist, who gave enormous respect for from the, among the scientific community to Russia. And theoretical physicists started enjoying much more respect in Russia. And Landau's theories are there again in solid state physics and in quantum mechanics. And his most important contribution has been in superconductivity, type 2 superconductors. And he used some phenomenological ideas. During the Second World War, the BCS theory, as it is called, we will see that a little later. BCS theory, which was discovered in the United States, did not reach Russia. And similarly, the Russian achievement did not reach United States. And the Russians published usually only in their own language. And he gave a phenomenological theory for type 2 superconductors. And this is the, people say it is really the best way, best theory of starting out of from the mind, which did not have any fundamental ideas. It just starts with only phenomenology. It should be like that, it should be like that. With that, he was able to explain the type of superconductivity. And later, the Americans realized the importance of this, and the Russians realized the importance of BCS theory. And some of other Russian scientists, like Abrikoshov, Gorkov, and others, they tried to couple both the theories, one how one comes from the other. Okay, and Landau is a great physicist. Not only that, Landau, first of all, proved to the world that a theoretical physicist must know everything in physics. And it's very, really difficult. But he published 5 or 6 volumes of theoretical physics.
Of course, that's more important. So, I wish you all the best. Thank you, and probably I hope you have enjoyed this lecture. And I am always free. And if you have any doubts, you want to contact me, you can contact me. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir, for your interesting talk. Sister?
Hello?
Sir, now what of thanks? What of thanks, sir?
Are you able to hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes?
Now what of thanks? What of thanks?
Yes?
A very good afternoon to everybody present here. Gratitude is the healthiest of all human emotions. It gives me an immense pleasure to deliver the oath of thanks for the virtual event to all the dignitaries assembled here. First of all, I thank the...
Are you able to hear me?
Yes, sir.
Huh?
Sir, kekudhu, sir. Inge pesuradhu. Hello, kekudhu.
Appa.
First of all, I thank the Almighty Lord for this wonderful day. This endowment lecture was conducted on the memory of Sister Rosamma. We express our warm gratitude to you, dear sister. I would like to thank our chief guest, Dr. K. Navaneeth Krishnan, former head and coordinator, School of Physics, Madurai Kamaraj University, for his valuable speech on various your thoughts and ideology were truly useful, motivational and inspiring. Thank you, sir. Next, I express my gratefulness to the secretary of our college, Dr. Sister Jaradan Jayam, for her valuable presence. Thank you, dear sister. I would like to thank the head of the Department of Physics, Dr. C. Nirmala Lewis, who has always been a great support to all the staffs and students. Thank you, ma'am. Last but not the least, I thank all my dear teachers and my fellow students for your valuable presence. Once again, thank you all.